this session is about electrical power train architecture, and these are the basic skills required for understanding this session. I mean, this is just basic Newton mechanics. That means basic kinematics and dynamics, which you studied. And I mean, any engineer will study up to his 12th class physics and some of the basic class of electrical circuits like Kirchhoff current law, Kirchhoff voltage law, and transients. And these are the basic mathematics, differential equations. Even we are not going with higher order differential equations. We're just focusing on first order differential equations. Okay. These are the contents of the slides. Just let me use the pointer actually. Yeah. The slides are organized in this following way. First, I will give the introduction about the basics of the automobile and basics of the powertrain architecture of the electric vehicle and why we are going for the high voltage. I mean, if you see in the present market, there are many players are there like Tigor EV, which are working at 72 volts, and Mahindra e-Verito, which is working at 72 volts. I think recently you were aware about Hyundai Kona, which is around operating around 300 volts, and Nexon EV, and MZ EV, which is operating around 300 to 400 voltage. Then we will I will try to explain why we need high voltage. Why not 72 volts? Why not 12 volts? Why not 48 volts? Since we are going with high voltage, which will require certain extra safety features, which is one of the safety features is insulation monitoring. Why we need insulation monitoring? How the insulation is monitored in an electric vehicle? And then, since we are going for high voltage, this is the second requirement, pre-charging of the DC link. Why we need the pre-charging of the DC link and how we are going to do the pre-charging of the DC link. Then the architecture, since all the electric vehicles, actually the main focus of this presentation is about electric vehicles, I mean plug-in electric vehicles. Since these are the plug-in electric vehicles, the way we are filling petrol or diesel in the normal conventional vehicle, we need to charge the batteries. So what are the different available architectures? What are the different protocols available in the XEV industry, especially electric vehicle industry, about the charging architecture? Then different charging protocols. I mean, this is also more into charging architecture. Then the last slide is about job profiles. What are the different job profiles available in this electric vehicle industry? So this is the organization of the slides. Before going much into the, today's presentation, I just want to give you an indication. I mean, if you are a mechanical engineer, if I'm trying to explain you basics of the automobile, it's just like I'm insulting you. And if you're an electrical engineer, and if I'm trying to explain about KVL, KCL, and transients, if I am at your place, I will felt like insulted. But don't felt like insulted, because I think our audience combines both electrical and mechanical engineers. And once you are completing your engineering and entering into the industry, there won't be much difference between electrical engineer and mechanical engineer. At the same time, you need to understand the basics. So just be with me. Don't felt insulted if I'm trying to explain the basic things. Maybe you just considered about your colleagues who are either electrical engineer or a mechanical engineer. So just let me go into the contents. This is about the basics of automobile. The basic purpose of automobile is locomotion. I mean, if you see the Carl Benz vehicle, it's actually electric vehicle, not a conventional internal combustion engine. So the basic purpose of automobile is locomotion. That means we need to move, at a higher velocity than a human being who is going to walk. So now let's understand what are the forces acting on an automobile when it is moving at a velocity of V. So if you see here, the force opposing the motion, these are because of the frictional force, which is, in this universe, or at least in Earth, if you are trying to move something, there is friction is always present, which is making us to walk on the earth. If the friction is not there, we can't walk on the earth. So frictional force is always present, which is opposing the motion, and the aerodynamic drag, because the gases which are present on the atmosphere, it is trying to oppose the motion actually. And force due to gradient, that means if you are trying to climb a gradient, that will also oppose the motion actually. So if you are trying to write it through a mathematical equation, the force of opposition, it is the A is actually, it combines static friction. I mean, the friction is there whether you are trying to move or you are not trying to move. This is always present. which is represented by a constant, and there is a frictional force which is proportional to the velocity, directly proportional to the velocity of the movement. This is also frictional component, and there is a C into V square. Actually, this is coming from the air drag. I mean, if you're trying to move something, the force of opposition because of the air drag, it is directly proportional to the square of the velocity, and it is directly proportional to the area of the frontal area. We used to call it as a frontal area. So how much is the frontal area of the automobile? It's proportional to that. And here CG represents that from a frontal area more or less. And next thing is force due to the gradient, because this is coming from the gravity. If you are trying to climb something, the gravity is always trying to oppose that climbing force. But if it is not a 90 degrees steep gradient, then that will be resolved into the components, sine and cosine components. So these are the three forces which is always trying to oppose the movement of the automobile. So next thing is about the tractive force. That means these forces are trying to oppose the movement of the automobile, and the tractive force, maybe I will get this tractive force either through the, internal combustion engine, or I can use a motor, irrespective of what we're going to use. I'm just trying to understand the basic equilibrium of the forces of the automobile. So the tractive force, I think everybody's aware, this is just 12th class physics. The torque is equal to the force into the radius. So from here, I am getting tractive force equal to T2 is the torque divided by the radius of the tire. So, and this is the third equation is about, this is from the Newton's equation. Difference of the two forces, if the tractive force is more than the opposing force, that will accelerate the automobile. If the tractive force is less than the opposition force, it will try to decelerate the automobile. So the deceleration and acceleration, it is directly proportional to the mass of the vehicle and the rate of change of velocity. So these all these things are all these equations and whatever I explained till now, this is from the 12th class physics. So let's go through this diagram which I presented here. We're having an internal combustion engine, and the output of the internal combustion engine, it is a torque, and based on the tractive force and opposing force, there will be either acceleration or deceleration. Based on the equilibrium of this acceleration or deceleration, it is operating at some RPM. Let's say N1 is the RPM, and I'm having a gearbox which will convert the torque and RPM into the T1 and N1 into T2 and N2 based on the ratio of the gearbox. That will convert the torque T1 N1 into T2 N2. This is there to use the engine efficiently at the same time to get the more torque from the engine. Whatever is requirement of the tractive force, that will be extracted by using different permutations and combinations of the gearbox. Let me go to the second slide where you will get more details. So actually this is the torque speed curve of the internal combustion engine. And if you see here, at the initial RPMs, at 100 RPM, 1000 RPM, or 15,000 RPM, the torque provided by the internal combustion is very less. So just assume you are driving at least two-wheeler. So at the first gear, when you are using the first gear, I think most of you at that experienced about stalling of the engine. The stalling happens because the torque provided by the engine, ultimately here, tractive force minus opposing force equal to the mass into acceleration. If the opposing force, especially torques, is more than the tractive torque, then the engine will decelerate. This will become minus the engine. Actually, rather than accelerating, it will decelerate. So if the engine decelerates, the torque applied, the torque provided by the engine will be lesser than the tractive opposing forces, which will cause stalling of the engine. So that means we need to control the torque provided by the engine, which is not, we are not able to use the engine efficiently without the gears. So what we will do is we will use different gears, first gear, second gear, third gear, and fourth gear, maybe in some cases up to sixth gear. What it is doing is it will convert the torque, T1 N1 into T2 N2 equal, both are equal because the law of conservation of energy. So by properly choosing a different gear ratio, I can convert the torque into, I can amplify the torque. At the same time, I will attenuate the speed. So this is what we are doing actually. And the second thing, if you see here, when I'm pressing the accelerator pedal, that will increase the fuel input into the engine, which will cause more torque. If the torque is more than the load torque, it will accelerate. If the engine accelerate means the engine RPM will increase. If the engine RPM increases, the torque will increase more. Then the automobile moves forward. In a conventional engine, the torque of the engine is controlled by the fuel input. That means which is coming from the accelerator pedal. If I press the accelerator pedal more, I will inject more fuel into the engine, I will get the more torque. This is the basic laws of internal combustion engine. Since I don't have any control on this characteristic, that means this will be fixed at the time of tuning of the engine. So to vary this torque, that means at different scenarios, I want different torques and different speeds. So to match this generated torque to the load torque, I will use the gearbox, which will convert the T1 torque into the required load torque. So now actually the basic purpose of automobile is the locomotion, but there are some auxiliary tasks, like we are using internal illumination, or I need to brake the automobile. If I'm not using power brake, it will be very difficult to stop the automobile. So these are some of the auxiliary systems which are used in automobile. First one is the alternator. If you want to start the engine, first you need to accelerate the, first you need to rotate the crankshaft. Then only the internal combustion Carnot cycle will start. So first to start that, we need certain amount of onboard power storage that will be coming from this battery. But this battery is to charge by somebody, that is done by the alternator. That means this alternator is mechanically coupled to the engine. When the engine is running, maybe mostly the ideal RPM is about, there is a difference between diesel engine and petrol engine, it will be between 1000 RPM to 1500 RPM, the idling speed. So the alternator will always charge once the vehicle is started, that will always charge this LV battery. At the same time, the alternator will drive the all the loads in the vehicle, whether it is the headlamps or the wipers of the windshield, all these things will be driven by the alternator only once the vehicle is cranked, even the stereo system of your automobile. So next thing is the vacuum pump. In a passenger vehicle, their braking system is controlled by the vacuum pump. The vacuum pump will create a vacuum. This is mechanically coupled to the engine shaft, the crankshaft. This will be keep on rotating. It will create vacuum. When somebody is trying to press the brake pedal, the vacuum sucks the brake pedal. That means it will assist the driver's force. It will try to suck the caliper, which will stop the movement of the disc brake, which will stop the automobile eventually. So the vacuum pump is mechanically coupled to the engine. Next one is the air compressor. In your automobile, when you are trying to use your AC, so that is driven by the, just like AC in your home, which require compression of a fluid, which will, when you expand that fluid, it will absorb the temperature. So to do this compression, you require a mechanical force. So this mechanical force is coming from a compressor, which is coupled with the internal combustion engine. Next one is the power steering. Maybe if you see the older automobiles or older internal combustion vehicles, it don't have a power steering. Maybe you can take care of, you can reference Ambassador, which is maybe even they used to print the brand power steering and AC. So before that, there is no power steering. So what the power steering will do is it will run a hydraulic pump that will be coupled to the engine itself. So which will run a hydraulic pump, and when try to rotate the steering, the hydraulic motor will assist you in turning the automobile. So these are all the auxiliary systems which is ran by the internal combustion itself. All these things are connected to the crankshaft of the engine. That means whatever is on engine RPM, that will fix the RPM of alternator. Actually, alternator is nothing but a DC generator, vacuum pump, or air compressor, or power steering. This is the basic internal combustion engine architecture. So now let's go to the basic purpose of this session is about XEV architecture. So let's try to analyze, let's try to compare what are the differences of the electric vehicle compared to the internal combustion vehicle. So the main difference is in an electric vehicle, there is no internal combustion engine. That means the traction is provided by electric motors. So there is no internal combustion engine. Let's see what are the basic components of a electric powertrain. HV battery is one of the basic component which will store the energy in case of a, you can think it of as a fuel tank. In case of internal combustion engine, the fuel tank will hold either diesel or petrol, which is having some amount of energy. So in case of an electric vehicle, the HV battery is the fuel tank. You can think it of, you can compare it to the fuel tank of a combustion engine. So next thing is the e-compressor. In case of internal combustion engine, this is an air compressor, which is coupled with the combustion engine mechanically. But in case of an electric vehicle, we call it as an e-compressor. That means electric compressor. Here, the vacuum pump is coupled, mechanically coupled to the internal combustion engine. But in case of a electric powertrain, there is no engine. So this vacuum pump is driven by a DC electric motor. So actually, this heater is an important one. Maybe you will wonder if I say what is the requirement of a heater. In automobile, what happens was, I mean, this is about internal cooling of your cabin. Since the air compressor is mechanically coupled to the internal combustion engine, the RPM of air compressor is fixed by the internal combustion engine, which is fixed by the at what velocity you want to travel. This is not in control of air compressor. Let's say I want to maintain my internal cabin temperature as 22 degrees. So I think everybody, most of the mechanical engineers especially, aware that the cooling power is coming from, I mean, you will compressor some form of a liquid. Usually we call it as a R15. So when you compress that liquid and when you try to expand, it will absorb the heat. So, but the compression is coming from the mechanical energy from the internal combustion engine, which is not in your control. So in conventional engine, what we used to do is the hot water is byproduct of the internal combustion engine. When it is combusting, when the internal combustion engine is running, we need to cool the engine to have higher life and better efficiency. So we used to do the cooling by using the water. So hot water is the byproduct of the internal combustion. So what people used to do is the air compressor will give certain amount of cooling. I mean, it will get the cool either air or fluid or liquid. And they used to mix this cool air or fluid with the hot air or liquid from the internal combustion engine. So the proportion of the mix depends upon what is the requirement. I mean, if somebody wants to maintain 22 degrees of internal cabin temperature, accordingly, the hot water and the cool liquid will be combined. But when you're coming to the electric powertrain, but most of the times, if you see, most of the vehicles are actually the retrofitment. If you see the Tata Nexon EV, they are just using Nexon EV to convert that into electric vehicle. So there, I mean, we used to call it as a HVAC. The HVAC system contains the same compressor which is used in the conventional engine. So even though the e-compressor, which is able to rotate at different RPMs based on the requirement, still they are combining hot water and cool liquid from the e-compressor to maintain the cabin temperature. That's why we have a heater also, which will emulate the engine and provide the hot liquid to control the cabin temperature. So next thing is the onboard charger. It's just like you can think it onboard charger as a fueling station. Since we are having the high voltage battery, which will store the energy in the form of a electrochemical process, so we need to provide the energy to the HV battery. That will be provided by the onboard charger or even the fast charger. That means if you want to quickly charge the HV battery, we use the fast charger. I will talk about this onboard charger and fast charger in the later slides. And next thing is the e-drive. This is actually basic purpose of the automobile. That means to provide the locomotion. So here, e-drive is nothing but a vector controlled, most of the cases, permanent magnet synchronous machine. Don't get confused by the technical jargons. You can just imagine you are having certain motor whose torque is controlled by the inverter. I mean, whatever the torque you want, that will be provided by the e-drive. And next thing is a DC-DC converter. If you see here, the auxiliary system is always run by the LV battery. So there should be somebody, because this is a low voltage battery, most of the cases, this is a lead acid battery. Somebody need to charge this battery. In case of a internal combustion engine, that will be done by the alternator, who is getting mechanical power from the internal combustion engine, which will convert this alternator into the electrical power and charge the battery. But in case of an electric vehicle, there is no mechanical movement. So the DC-DC converter, it will emulate the alternator, which will convert the battery power. Most of the cases, it can be either 72 volts or 330 volts, or maybe sometimes it's up to 500 volts based on the type of the high voltage architecture. So the DC-DC converter will convert this high voltage into low voltage, and it will charge the LV battery of the automobile. Next thing is traction and coolant pumps. If you are not aware, the battery will be operated efficiently within a certain band of temperature. And if you see the tropical countries like India, the variation of the temperature is wide. So there should be an active cooling system. This is not required by the internal combustion engine, but in case of HV battery, this is required to prolong the battery life at the same time to efficiently use the battery. So this requires traction. I mean, even the traction is coming from the e-drive, DC-DC converter, onboard charger. All these components will use e-compressor, vacuum pump. They will use the power electronic components. Basically, the power electronic components will work up to 150 degrees centigrade. But the battery will work, it will efficiently work up to, maybe you can stretch it to 40 degrees. From maybe 10 degrees to 40 degrees, you can stretch. So the battery requires active cooling. That means just like AC in your home. But remaining power electronic components require passive cooling, just like an engine. So it is having two different coolant systems, traction and battery coolant pumps. Traction coolant pump, it won't require active cooling, but battery coolant pump, the refrigerant, it requires active cooling. Next one is a power distribution box. You can imagine it as a spike box, because all these components require high voltage connection. So this is coming from a spike box sort of thing, which is having different relays, fuses for protection, because we are dealing with the high voltage. And it is having different plug points. You can just imagine it as a plug points. Here, this slide explains different components, and this slide explains the connection, interconnection of different components. Let's go from the electrical side. So the traction battery pack, it is connected with the power distribution system. Maybe here I'm taking 250 volts to 450 volts. If you take the passenger cars, I'm taking passenger cars as the reference in all the slides, and I'll explain why the passenger cars are operating mostly between these voltages, 250 to 450 volts. What is the reason? That is also I will explain. But to take the, all the remaining electronic components require this much amount of voltage. If you see the onboard charger, it is getting the voltage from the, actually it is getting the voltage from the power grid. The purpose of onboard charger is charging the battery, traction battery pack. And if you see the e-drive means it is inverter plus motor plus gearbox. This is driving the wheels. So this will require the energy. This is also kind of electrical energy. This is also converted to the power distribution box. Similarly, the DC-DC converter, this is also connected to the, in this slide, it is not shown exactly, but this is also connected to the power distribution box. And the cooling system, if you see here, this is a coolant flow. The traction system consists of onboard charger, e-drive, DC-DC converter. So this requires different sort of coolant flow. And the traction battery, it requires, this should be operated between 10 degree and 40 degree. This requires active cooling. That's why the e-compressor, which will provide coolant flow both for cabin cooling and battery cooling. So the cabin cooling is not shown here. Actually, this is about HV architecture of electric powertrain, and the cabin cooling is not part of the electric powertrain. That's why that is not shown. But the refrigerant, which is flown, we used to call it as a heat exchanger. So the battery cooling system will exchange certain amount of coolant power from the e-compressor, which will cool the traction battery eventually. So next, let's come to this AC charging, AC or DC charging. We need to charge the traction battery, just like we are fueling the IC engine by using either petrol or diesel. So first it will convert that either AC or DC. There are two types of charging. So I will talk about these types of charging later in the slides. There is a vehicle connector, just like fuel flap, we are having a connector because we need to connect this AC power into the vehicle. So that will be connected into the vehicle inlet. So this AC power, in case we are talking about the AC power, that is converted into DC power by the onboard charger, which will charge the battery eventually. So this is the basic architecture of the high voltage electric powertrain.